Want to virtualize your biggest workloads? Bring the performance of cloud computing inside your data center with the only server built from the cloud up.
Everybody, welcome back to another episode of TechNet Radio. In this series, we're talking about Hyper-V from a VMware admin's perspective. And my name is Keith Mayer. I'm a senior technical evangelist at Microsoft for private cloud and hybrid cloud, Windows Server, Hyper-V, System Center, and Windows Azure. And I've worked a lot with IT pros, both on the VMware side of the house as well as the Hyper-V side of the house. So today we're going to be looking at Hyper-V with our good friend Andy Serwich from Trivalent Group. Hey, Andy, how are you today?
Good. How are you doing, Keith?
Great. Thanks for joining us again to talk about Hyper-V and your experiences as you've been comparing and contrasting both. Andy, could you give everyone a brief introduction of who you are, your background, and the organization that you work for?
Yeah, will do. So again, my name is Andy Serwich. I am a virtual systems administrator for Trivalent Group Incorporated, based out of Grand Rapids, Michigan. I work a lot with VMware and Hyper-V now in the last year. We kind of started out as a primarily VMware shop, kind of dabbling in the Hyper-V stuff a little bit now. So we've started demoing that a little bit. In regards to Trivalent, Trivalent is a service provider based out of Grand Rapids, Michigan again. And we provide products and services that help customers manage, access, protect, and store their data. That's our kind of our motto, and that's the way we do things. So
wow, okay. So you've got some experience really from kind of both sides of the fence, so to speak, where
Right. You
have consultants that are out in the field and helping customers with their own on-premises data center architectures using Hyper-V and VMware, and then you also have your own substantial hosted data center offerings where you're using VMware and Hyper-V in your data center as part of your managed service offerings. Is that right?
Correct. Yep.
Oh, awesome. Great. Well, I know that you've been over the last several months really looking closely at Hyper-V in Server 2012 and Server 2012 R2.
Yep.
And at your existing base of VMware hosts. And in this series, we're going to be talking about some of the key areas that you really saw some differentiation or value or were at least interested in making sure that Hyper-V was on par with VMware, on par or better than VMware.
Right.
So when you think about those areas, Andy, what area did you want to talk about today as a focus area?
You know, I think a good area to focus on and one thing that is, you know, very beneficial for system admins all over the place is live migration of virtual machines. The ability to do that on the fly without affecting the customer or, you know, if you're an internal IT team, without affecting your end users, that is very, 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 very important.
Yeah, definitely. And, you know, certainly from a planned downtime standpoint, I've seen a lot of customers use live VM migration or on the VMware side, what we would know as vMotion VMs, to be able to easily evacuate a host that might have some hardware maintenance that needs to be performed on it with all the VMs, without having to take the VMs down, evacuate those VMs from host to host running live. And I know in the Server 2012 release, we've actually had some improvements not only around speed and ability to do multiple concurrent live migrations, but also in terms of an area that we were initially calling shared nothing live migration, being able to live migrate VMs even if there were no shared storage between a couple Hyper-V hosts. It's kind of interesting. We initially launched that feature prior to it being available on the VMware stack, and then with vSphere 5.1, they kind of caught up to us in that area. From a shared nothing standpoint, Andy, is that something that you've seen useful for customers or perhaps in your own data center environment to be able to live migrate hosts back or VMs back and forth between hosts without shared storage necessarily being a requirement?
Yeah, absolutely. We've really seen that be a game changer, especially in the SMB space. You know, kind of mid-market, we've seen a little bit of benefit there as well for those customers that don't really have an investment in some sort of central storage infrastructure. So it's really been handy there. The other benefit we've seen is if a customer has, you know, maybe one host and they really need an upgrade done or they need some maintenance on their hardware, sometimes it's nice to be able to bring out, you know, like a swing server is what we call it. Basically, it's just a host that we temporarily put in place, move their VMs over to it while they're live, do the maintenance on their standalone host, move everything back, and, you know, we've patched up their host or we fixed some hardware issues without any impact to the customer whatsoever. So that's wow. definitely beneficial.
That's an interesting idea when you have those smaller single host installations. Yep. The other area that I've seen with some larger environments for IT pros getting value out of the Shared Nothing Live migration is when they think about the difference between like a pilot or a dev environment that's virtualized versus their production environment. A lot of times their production environment, they, you know, might be, you know, blown out to be clustered with shared storage and whatnot between all those hosts, but their dev or test or pilot environment might just be a single host or a couple standalone hosts with direct attached storage. And being able to use the live VM migration has allowed them to be able to easily swing VMs running live from dev or test or pilot environments over to production or from production back to dev and test if needed as they're going through the development lifecycle on applications and kind of proving those out. So that's been really interesting as well. And then, you know, so guys, folks, don't get us wrong, you know, we can certainly do live VM migrations between hosts that have shared storage as well, but the Shared Nothing was a new feature in the 2012 timeframe. In terms of shared storage, we also had some new introductions that I don't think got as much attention as they probably should have in the Server 2012 timeframe, because, you know, a lot of people associated shared storage automatically with clustering. And certainly clustering is important if you're looking to create an environment that has some high availability around it for unplanned downtime. But if you're just looking for quicker live migrations, with the changes that we made available in the server message block or SMB stack for shared folders in Server 2012, the ability to have just a couple unclustered standalone Hyper-V hosts that are connected to a shared folder and putting all of your virtual machines and hard disks in that shared folder and using that as a shared storage location between your hosts, really, you know, inexpensive, cost-effective solution. Again, maybe in that SMB market or the next level up in the smaller mid-market organizations where they don't have the budget to endure, you know, putting in place a full cluster. That's actually an interesting option as well. Have you seen any of your customers using the file share storage mechanism for storing virtual machines and virtual hard disks, Andy?
We've seen a little bit of interest in that so far. Like you said, I don't think there was. It wasn't a whole lot of kind of press release around it. I don't think the word really got out there as much as some of the other 2012 stuff, but we've started to see a little bit of interest in that. And like you said, primarily in the SMB space, that's becoming a really economical option.
Yeah, definitely. And then certainly, you know, full clustered systems where we want high availability and clustered failover for unplanned downtime, and then quick live migrations between hosts within a cluster for planned downtime and manual load balancing of the VMs is certainly a best practice configuration for larger environments with Hyper-V.
Yes, absolutely.
And then we also have because we can do the Shared Nothing, even in those larger environments, though, one of the interesting aspects that I've seen is being able to do Shared Nothing live migrations between clusters, so that if a customer has an older cluster and they're looking to put in place a newer cluster, or if they have a couple clusters that they're using for different portions of their organization, they can actually now, with the Shared Nothing capability, they can do cluster live migrations as well. So that's kind of interesting.
It's really beneficial in those situations where you've got multiple clouds, you know, maybe combination of on-premise and, you know, service provider clouds. It's kind of really helpful in those situations.
Yep, definitely. And this actually brings up one of we've been talking a lot about live migration in terms of the 2012 release, but as we both know, and many of our listeners know, 2012 R2 just became available on October 18th, just a couple weeks ago. And one of the new features in terms of live migration that 2012 R2 offers is cross-platform live migration, so that as you're looking to migrate a host or even an entire cluster from server 2012 to server 2012 R2, you can build your new server 2012 host or build your new server 2012 R2 cluster and do live VM migration from 2012 to 2012 R2 without having to take any of your VMs down, without having to do exports and imports or anything of that nature. Makes the whole migration process much easier to orchestrate.
Yes, much easier to get the authorization on the upgrade as well, just because, yay, no downtime, you know?
So right.
It makes it a lot easier from that standpoint.
Exactly. No, definitely. Well, and there's a number of other enhancements to live migration in the R2 release, but I think it would be better if we maybe jumped into our lab environment with everyone so that we could talk about them, you and I could talk about them, Andy, as we're looking at the various tools and screens and whatnot. Does that make sense from your standpoint?
Yeah, sounds good.
Okay, great. Well, let's jump over into the lab then. Well, Andy, here we are over in our lab environment, and we've been talking about live migration. One of the things that we didn't mention yet, but we probably should for everyone's benefit, is that live migration is actually a feature that's provided across all of the Hyper-V SKUs in Server 2012 and in 2012 R2. So unlike some of the competing products out there, you don't have to buy a special version of Hyper-V in order to get live migration. It's just baked into the core. Even if you're using our completely free Hyper-V Server 2012 or Hyper-V Server 2012 R2 bare metal hypervisor, you still get all of the live migration and clustering and scale support that Hyper-V has in the paid editions of Windows Server. But because of that, we've got a few different tools that could be used to manage live migrations. We've got Hyper-V Manager, which is what we're looking at right now in our lab. Yep. And that works well in kind of those small and medium markets where they haven't quite gotten to clustering yet. But if you're in a clustered environment, you can use Failover Cluster Manager as your console instead to manage your hosts and virtual machines and do all your live migration inside of that. And then when you get into larger environments where you might have multiple clusters, we also have the live migration support plugged into VMM, System Center 2012 Virtual Machine Manager. The nice thing is that it's plugged into each console in a way that's consistent. The features all work consistently, so you don't have to worry about leveraging multiple tools. You can pick the tool that's appropriate for the environment that you're working in, and just leverage that and have access to live migration.
So that's the thing I always liked about the Microsoft solutions in regards to Hyper-V and live migrations and clustering. You're just using MMC. You're using the tool set that you're already familiar with and comfortable with. So you don't have to learn a new third-party tool to get the job done. So I've always appreciated that.
Cool. Great. Well, and we had mentioned that in the 2012 R2 release that there's some additional new features beyond the cross-platform live migration. We've also got some other features to help achieve much better results and scenarios with live migration. In Hyper-V Manager, I've got two Windows Server 2012 R2 hosts with the Hyper-V role installed, already connected. And when we go over to our Actions pane, and drill into Hyper-V settings in the Actions pane, we can drill down into the category where we configure live migrations. And both 2012 R2 and 2012 offer what we call unlimited simultaneous or concurrent live migrations. And they've actually gotten into a lot of interesting discussions with the VMware community, because VMware, on the current version of vSphere 5.5 Enterprise Plus, instead of giving the flexibility of being able to choose the maximum number of simultaneous live migrations that you wish to perform, it's instead capped at either 4 concurrent live migrations for if you're using 1 gigabit Ethernet connections for vMotioning on the VMware side, or 8 concurrent live migrations if you're using 10 gigabit networking. And whereas on our side, we don't put necessarily a hard set cap on it. We default to 2 when you enable it, but you can put this up to 20 if you have hardware and network connectivity to support that number of simultaneous live migrations. And we've seen that really useful in the larger scale-up environments where you have environments that are running 70, 80 VMs on some very large clustered hosts. And when they need to evacuate a host, they don't want to wait for 2, 4, or 8 of those VMs to move at a time. They've got very high-speed network connections between their hosts for live migration, and they want to be able to do the live migrations in larger batches back and forth. But from your perspective, I know you've got a lot of background on the VMware side, and do you see this as an advantage from your perspective in Hyper-V?
Yeah, it's certainly nice to be able to get things done quicker. From a service provider perspective, customers call and they always want things done, as soon as possible. And being able to do that, evacuate the host quicker, that definitely helps with it. So,
and what we saw on our side in Server 2012 is a lot of environments bumped it up to maybe 10, 12, 15, 20, based on their network architecture, to be able to do those quicker batches of live migrations. Oftentimes, though, because live migration involves host-level CPU resources as well as network resources that the host may be leveraging for other purposes, they sometimes weren't able to get quite up to that level from a practical standpoint. So what we've done in the 2012 R2 realm, under our advanced features of live migration, is we've actually given a couple new options for live migration. I'm going to start at the bottom and work my way up. One of those options is an option that we call live migration over SMB Direct. And it's actually confused a few people because we already talked previously about the ability to run Hyper-V VMs over a SMB shared folder and be able to live migrate without having to move the storage back and forth. This option, though, is a little different because what it does is it doesn't leverage the full SMB stack. It leverages a particular component of the SMB stack that we call SMB Direct that allows live migration to interface with high-speed network cards in your servers that use remote direct memory access or RDMA capabilities. The benefit that has is RDMA offloads the CPU strain that traditional live migrations have directly down into the NIC and does a blast of your VM memory state contents host to host without having that same CPU overhead. So we're actually seeing a lot of environments taking advantage of this because they're moving towards 10 gig Ethernet in their data centers, and many 10 gig and faster network cards today have RDMA support built into them. If you have those NICs in your data center and in your hosts already, being able to do live migration over RDMA is a big benefit to be able to capitalize on larger volumes of simultaneous live migrations. It also, even when you look at an individual live migration, by doing the live migration over RDMA versus doing it over a normal IP session, it offers about a 10 times improvement in the speed of how quickly we can move VMs between hosts. Going back to your point of being really useful for being able to evacuate hosts quickly when it comes to planned maintenance and whatnot. What's your perspective on the RDMA support? Is that something that you think you may begin leveraging in your environments as you deploy hosts that have RDMA capabilities?
Absolutely. I liked how you described it because blast is the appropriate terminology in my opinion. The first time I saw a demo of the RDMA live migration support, it's astounding how much faster it is than a standard live migration.
Yep, definitely. Now, even if you don't have those 10 gig or faster network cards with RDMA support in your hosts today, we do also offer another enhanced option that's kind of a middle of the road between normal IP-based live migration and SMB, and that's the compression option. The compression option, what it attempts to do is leverage unused CPU cycles on each of the hosts where you're migrating a VM from and to compress the memory state of that VM before it transfers that over the network, so that there's less to transfer host to host from a network payload standpoint, and then decompress it over on the other side. What we're seeing in real-world use cases of compression in environments where they may have just maybe 1 gig network interfaces that they're doing live migration over is about a 2x acceleration of live migration over the normal TCP/IP option that was present in Server 2012, that first option that you see on our screen. Because of that improvement and because of the ability of compression to operate regardless of having any special network card hardware in place, compression's actually the default option now for Server 2012 R2 when you enable live migration. So when you're doing R2 to R2, live VM migration is going to use compression by default and fall back to TCP/IP if you're doing that cross-platform live migration we talked about going from Server 2012 over to Server 2012 R2. Does that make sense from your standpoint? Do you think compression is something that I imagine you guys probably have a lot of hosts that are, or a lot of customers that are still using 1 gig Ethernet. Seems like compression might be a good solution for them in that case. What do you think, Andy?
I think it would help, certainly. You know, the faster you can move stuff, the better. One concern that I know some of my fellow engineers have always brought up, and some customers, you know, they're saying unused CPU cycles, you know, that they find it hard to believe that it's not going to impact the production workload on the host at the time. But, you know, from what I've read and from what I've seen, it truly is the unused cycles. I've never seen it impact the production workload on a host yet.
Yep. And even in very large customer environments, I rarely see customers running their virtualization hosts at such a level that they're risking overcommitment.
Well, yeah.
Today, you know, so there's always a little bit of spare wiggle room for being able to take advantage of features like compression that can kind of step in, use those CPU cycles when it's needed, and then step back out when the live migration is completed.
Yeah, if you're running your host in a 90-95% utilization range, you got other problems.
Right, exactly.
Absolutely.
Okay, great. Well, the other area that has led to some interesting conversations in the field with IT pros is being able to do live VM migration over multiple network interfaces, because in a lot of cases, IT pros want to be able to have, you know, they want to be able to live migrate VMs using more network bandwidth than a single NIC provides. And in Server 2012, we had some ability to do that with NIC teaming that was provided as part of the base Server 2012 OS, but the load balancing algorithms didn't necessarily load balance the traffic between two Hyper-V hosts in a way that would balance a single VM live migration between all the available NICs. So we've made some changes to improve that in R2 as well. One of those changes is actually related to the option that we talked about a little earlier, using SMB Direct. If you have those faster 10 gig Ethernet RDMA enabled network cards and you're using live migration over SMB Direct, the other feature that comes into place is a feature called SMB Multichannel, where it'll take those multiple connections and automatically load balance across those or create multiple sessions inside of a single high-speed connection to be able to use up as much of the network bandwidth that you're giving live migration. But the other way that we can do that, if I cancel out of the screen, if we don't have NICs that have SMB Direct RDMA support in them, is that we can also team them, but we've made some changes in the R2 release as to how load balancing works with NIC teaming to optimize load balancing better for single host to single host live migration. And I've got, I'm going to just bring up my server manager screen, and we're on the local server, our local Hyper-V host running Windows Server 2012 R2. And you'll notice that under NIC teaming, I look over to the right, I've got NIC teaming set to enabled. Well, if I click on that enabled link, it's going to bring up my NIC teaming wizard. And in that Nick Teaming Wizard, you'll see that I've already created a team of a couple 1 gig, just standard 1 gig network interfaces. And the load balancing that it's using is using a new load balancing mode called dynamic. What dynamic does is instead of load balancing based on IP address or load balancing based on IP port, TCP or UDP port address, it instead load balances on what we call flowlets within a TCP or UDP conversation. So it takes a single stream of packets, breaks them up into flowlets, and then divides those flowlets across your multiple physical NICs so that if you're using something like a live migration session to live migrate a big VM from, or a big set of VMs from one host to another host, you'll get much better distribution and load sharing without any special configurations or drivers or third-party software across those various NICs. So that's a nice feature as well. And then certainly with the teaming, by having multiple physical NICs in the team, it also gives you some network layer resiliency as well. In the event that a single NIC path fails, you still have the remaining NIC path that all of your traffic will fail over to. Andy, in your environments, is NIC teaming something that you've used frequently in your own environment or customers?
Yeah, we're starting to see adoption of this technology quite a bit more. And in my experience, I found that it's using the native built-in 2012 NIC teaming, it functions a lot better than the old third-party NIC teaming utilities that you get from Broadcom and HP. Those ones always seem to be problematic, especially when you were using some sort of offload feature, in the virtual space. So the ability to do this here is very, very nice. We're starting to see adoption of it quite a bit.
Great. Well, that's awesome. Well, we've looked at some of the new improvements from a live migration standpoint with 2012 R2, being able to do live migration over RDMA, being able to do compression just with standard network cards to speed up our live migrations, some additional options at a NIC teaming level that we can leverage. Well, from your perspective, Andy, what do you think? Is live migration of VMs, would you say it's on par with VMware's capabilities in the vSphere realm, or are you seeing some big benefits that are even beyond what VMware's been able to deliver in the past?
I would say I'm seeing some benefits beyond what VMware has been doing in the past. I mean, yeah, they can do it. They've been doing vMotion for a long time, but especially in the large enterprise space, the ability to do it as quickly and as efficiently as Hyper-V is doing it now with 2012 R2, that's really, in my opinion, it's quite a bit better.
Awesome. Well, let's jump back over to our offices and we'll finish up our session today. So today, everyone, we were looking at some of the new improvements in live migration in Server 2012 R2 and our free Hyper-V Server 2012 R2 products with our good friend Andy Sirwich from Trivalent Group. Keep in mind that down below on the page, you'll find links to Andy's blog and my blog with lots of other great resources if you're interested in going further and learning more about Hyper-V in the R2 releases. I'd encourage you to visit those links. Andy, thanks so much for joining us today. I really appreciate your insight on live migration and how it compares from your experience over to vMotion.
Hey, not a problem. Thanks for having me, Keith.
Sure thing. And thank you, everyone, for joining us today. I look forward to having you back for our next episode of Hyper-V from a VMware Admin's Perspective. Thanks, everyone. Have a great rest of your day.
See ya.